Good evening, everybody, and thank you, Ortho TV, Manish Dhawan, Delhi Orthopedic Association. I think it's an excellent idea of doing these webinars. Today's topic being hip, we start with the first talk, which is on history taking in a hip case, and I would start with this quote of William Osler, which says, "Medicine is a science of uncertainty and an art of probability." I think this stands amazingly true in these difficult times of the pandemic, when it is a science of uncertainty and developing into an art of probability. One of the most important cases, the hip case, every 3 out of 5 candidates get hip as a long case usually. And the interesting part of hip evaluation is that it actually trains a postgraduate into the various parts of evaluating a patient, and that is why it becomes such an important part and is taken as a long case. So history taking in a hip case would in all other scenarios would move around these pillars, which are patient data collection, the presenting complaint, history of present illness, the past history, the treatment history, and the social history. So you move from the patient data and end your history taking with the social history. This is actually similar in most parts, and each component of these would be slightly different in each part which you are evaluating. So let's try and understand each part separately in a bit of a detail, and I will assure there's going to be a lot of repetition in these next 10 minutes about what you need to do in history taking. So history taking, it is as important as examination. Should be thoughtful, systematic, and comprehensive. Usually by the end of history, one should be able to conceptually bring forward a bunch of probable diagnoses or what condition we are dealing with. We need to have some amount of differential diagnosis in our mind, 1, 2, 3. It is usual for an examiner to ask at the end of the history, what is in your mind after getting this history? Be prepared for it. So starting with demographic data, this is a normal thing which we do day in and day out. But at times we miss out a few important things. So there's an interesting mnemonic for this. Nasomra. N is for name, A is for age, S is for sex, O is for occupation, M is for marital status, R is for residential address, and A is for admission date or when the patient came to you. So if you have such mnemonics with you, the probability that you will miss out will be less. And it's not a bad idea when you start your practice of taking history to stick certain mnemonics which will help you. Now, maybe all these have a bearing on the diagnosis as well as management of your patient. Like for example, sickle cell disease normally come from belts which have higher incidence of sickle cell disease. So maybe it correlates with the diagnosis of avian. Certain sex are more related to certain diseases like rheumatoid arthritis and ankylosing spondylitis. Age, you very well know, Perthes disease, SCFE, DDH, they would have a particular age when the patient comes to you. And occupation, of course, is going to tell you something about what could be the disease, and it will help you on deciding upon the management. So the starting point after the demographic data is the presenting complaint. We have to be very clear and crisp about what is the presenting complaint, and we need to present it in a chronological order. Meaning the complaint which came first, for example, pain in the right hip for the last 3 months and limp in the right lower limb for the past 7 days. So whatever complaint comes first, it should be told first with the number of days or months, and whatever complaint came next comes next. So the presenting complaint has to be very clear and it should come with the duration. So normally it is in the patient's own words. And if you take a hip case, the usual complaints in a hip case are pain, swelling, limp, inability to bear weight, limitation of movements, deformity or a limb length discrepancy. So each complaint is to be mentioned in the order of occurrence of the chronology I have explained, and then you go ahead describing each complaint on the broad base of onset, duration and progression. So ODP could be another mnemonic. So history of presenting illness, how do you get it out? You ask the patient, when were you absolutely okay? You actually have to take him back to a place, to a timeline where he was absolutely okay, so that he can actually juggle out and actually tell you the right amount of duration he's been having that illness. And after that, you need to ask him, what happened then? But then there would be some patients who would come out with a history, I have been ill for the whole of my life. So you need to be juggling around with these patients, and maybe at times you need to ask them, what has brought you to the hospital today if your problem has been there for ages? So you have to modify your questioning at times, which have to be straightforward, or at times you have to encourage the patient to speak out. So the common complaints around the hip. Now this part we're going to repeat two or three times in the next 10 minutes. Pain, which is going to be the most important. Swelling. Function loss. Now the function loss could be in standing, maybe on both feet or one limb. In walking, it could be in sitting, chair, squatting or cross leg, or it could be in lying down. And then the patient could come with a presentation of a deformity. So what do we need to describe about each symptom? We need to describe on the onset, the course, the duration, any treatment taken or given, and what has been the response. So the broad outline for each symptom would be on these grounds. But in pain, there would be certain addition things. We are more interested in understanding what is the exact site, the character, the intensity, and radiation. So normal symptoms, you want to know the onset, and you want to know the duration and the progress. But in pain, you want to know certain more things. So another mnemonic is there to help you, which is by the name of Socrates. So each word means something. S for site, where is the pain? O for onset, when did the pain start? And whether it was sudden, gradual, the character, what is the pain like? Is it stabbing or throbbing or dull aching? Radiation, does the pain radiate anyway? Association, any other sign or symptom which is related to this pain? Time, the course. Does the pain follow any time duration? Exacerbation and relieving factors. Does anything change the pain? And the last thing, the severity. How bad is the pain? So Socrates is one of the good mnemonic to remember, so that you do not miss out any of the features related to pain. So something more on pain, a different perspective. This being the commonest symptom in a hip case, the side, is it left or right, or is it bilateral? In case of bilateral, is it symmetrical, or one side is more painful than the other? The site, where exactly is it? Is the patient pointing towards the groin? Is it on the lateral side, or is it on the gluteal area? The onset, sudden insidious onset, or the patient is not clear on the onset. Duration, and is this duration related to remissions and relapses? The severity, mild, moderate or severe. The character, dull, sharp, throbbing. Radiation, time, is it continuous? Is it intermittent, or is it activity related? Is there a diurnal variation? Is night pain a very, very prominent phenomena associated? What are the aggravating factors? Does movement increase the pain? What are the relieving factors? Invariably rest, medication, these are two commonest. Progressive over time. Is pain progressive over time? What is the present status of the pain and what disability is it causing? So the severity, progression, present status and disability it is causing can objectively be shared from the patient by sharing the visual analog score or asking him to score it from 0 to 10, which will give you some objective idea. It might not be very easy for many patients to come out with it, but if you try it, it gives the clinician a very, very objective way of understanding where he's moving. Now, the side infective disorders like TB hip, septic sequelae invariably are unilateral, inflammatory could be bilateral, AVN if post-traumatic could be unilateral, if it is maybe steroid related can be bilateral. So all these features are going to take you towards what is the diagnosis in a patient. Site, very important, invariably it is the anteromedial groin plane which the hip produces, and be careful if it is a gluteal pain. Better check up on the spine and the back and be sure that the pain is coming from where. The next important symptom would be a limp, and we want to know the onset, we want to know the duration, you want to know whether it is painful or painless. Now this one association separates the diagnosis into two groups. A painful limp and a painless limp gives you a different list of diagnoses. And if you broadly divide it, invariably childhood limps are painless and invariably adulthood limps are painful. This is a rough sort of a assessment. Progression over time. What sort of a walking does the patient have if he has a limp? Does he need assistance? Is it an assisted gait or he's still continuing unassisted? Or he's just not able to walk? At times, limp could be the first symptom in TB hip even before pain. And as I've already told you, a painless limp is a very, very common presentation in the pediatric age group. Next symptom, which might not come out from the patient straight away unless you probe and sort of get it out, if your history is pointing towards such a thing. A swelling, we need to know the site and the site. We need to know the onset in relation to the other symptoms. We need to know the duration, whether it is painful or painless, whether it is associated with a scar or a sinus, and what is the progression over time and what is the present status. So the ODP continues in the various symptoms. So in similar way, history about each symptom should be elicited and noted. And with each symptom, you want to know, and invariably the patient has taken some treatment. So you need to end up each symptom details, description by what treatment he has taken. Like one example I have written down here is that for these complaint, patient took treatment from a local medical practitioner and got treatment in the form of oral medications, tractions, but got only partial relief of his symptoms, so he consulted this hospital 4 days back. So you need to summarize some amount of treatment given with the presenting complaints. Remember, the presenting complaints with a hip case are not going to be many. And then finally, you need to summarize in maybe one line on the current functional status of the patient. One example could be, at present, the patient is walking with the help of walker only at his home. He is unable to attend to his occupation. He is able to sit on a chair but unable to sit cross-legged or squat. So it gives you a bird's eye picture of what sort of a functional status the patient is having on the basis of history itself. And then the negative history, recent significant trauma, fever, the type of fever, cough, contact with the TB patient, whether the patient has a morning stiffness, whether he has other joints involved. So depending upon the symptomatology, you would like to present a negative history, which will actually support your diagnosis at the end of the day. So next comes is the past history. You want to know something about similar episodes of these symptoms in the past. you want to know any associations of other symptom, of other systems, whether it is CVS, whether it is respiratory system, whether it is abdominal, and you can just in your mind look for symptoms from head to toe and ask the patient if they might have an association with your presenting complaint. So you want to have a past history of trauma, surgery around the hip, long treatment undertaken, any history of tuberculosis, any dermatological disease for which the patient might have taken steroids, any long hospitalization, or any surgery for any illness. Then comes the social history. It has two parts to it, the personal history and the family history. The social history aids you in the diagnosis as well as discussing the treatment with the patient once you have come to a diagnosis. So in a personal history, again, I will take this quote from William Osler. It is much more important, he says, to know what sort of a patient has a disease. He's assuming that you would know what sort of a disease the patient has, but he emphasizing that you should know what type of a patient you are dealing with. You need to know his personal details, commonly the diet, the alcohol intake, smoking, any other addictions, and females, the menstrual history. The family history, history of any significant illness in the family or any similar disorder. You have to take a history of tuberculosis contact, any inflammatory arthropathy in the siblings or the parents, any metabolic disorders or hematological disorders. Family history is also important to understand what support system the patient might have to you to decide upon what sort of treatment you can offer him. So you're almost through your history cycle, and be ready with this. The examiner might ask you, or even yourself when you're looking at a patient in a clinic, you want to come to some provisional diagnosis at the end of the history. In an adult, it could be an ankylosis, it could be an arthritis or a synovitis, it could be a post-traumatic situation or any other thing. You need to figure out something in your mind. In the exam, you might be asked about, or you might not be asked about, what is the causative part of the provisional diagnosis. And I would request, don't jump to a very, very specific, detailed diagnosis on the history base itself. A common diagnosis could be a fibrous ankylosis in an unsound position, maybe an infective etiology. But don't spell out a very, very specific diagnosis, because that is actually not possible with just history. So, summarizing at the end, you need to take the patient data, you need to have the presenting complaint very clear with the duration, the history of illness on the onset, duration and the progression, past history, treatment history and the social history. So this is a broad plan which I have shared. You might have to add, delete or change the plan depending upon what case scenario you're dealing with. There would be many other parts which need to be a part of your history, which will actually build up during this 2-hour symposium when we are talking about specific case scenarios in the subsequent lectures. One good habit could be, as we make notes whenever we go through any topic we read, most institutes have their own hip performer. You might develop one of your own and then practice your history taking on this, so that it becomes a very, very automatic phenomenon for you yourself when you go ahead doing it in the exam. So to end, I would like to share this slide, which is a very, very common practice I do. I divide my OPD sheet into 4 boxes. The first box is history, the second is examination, the third is investigation, and the fourth is treatment. And that is how we manage our cases, and that is how this symposium is drawn to give you knowledge about a hip case. Thank you very much.